Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, SLCTV will feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair, because the lecture hall is about to begin.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome. It's nice to see so many faces in the room. It's great. We have some people dressed as bats. I love that part. So we seem to have a really polar group, those that love and those that hate bats, which is typical. Tonight we're going to talk specifically about some of the myths and misconceptions that surround bats. And let me just start with saying that bats have been vilified and wrongly and unjustly hated throughout history for hundreds and hundreds of years. And I believe it's because early people thought they saw these dark shapes flying out from underneath the ground during the nighttime hours at dusk. And many people back in those days had deep superstitions and fear of the dark and fear of the night. And they, I think, assigned the role of those nighttime creatures to the minion of the devil, because that was a very strong motivational force in that day. And these kinds of myths and misconceptions have unfortunately carried over in many cultures, even here in the United States, which, by the way, is the most educated nation on the planet but knows nothing about bats, which I find shocking. So that's one of the reasons I, about 5 years ago, threw my tools on the floor and said, that's it, no more field work. I'm going to start talking to people about the value of these animals, the importance of these animals, why they are a big part of our daily life, even if you don't believe they are. Some of the things that we know about bats today have just blown us away, and every single year we are discovering new species. We're discovering new things about bats and their biology. We're discovering that bats live super long lives and they stay healthy for 99% of their life. That suddenly they just seem to drop dead. And why? We don't know. We're trying to do research to figure that out. We've learned that bats don't get heart disease. Bats don't get arthritis. Bats don't age the same way some of the other mammals on Earth do, including us. And if we can translate some of those things that we can learn from bats into human health care, who knows, we might live longer lives and healthier lives while we're here. So those are all things we can learn from bats. Let's go ahead and start the program, Bats, Myth, and Reality. I would like to ask you, if you have questions, to please hold them till the end. I know that's hard to do, but do your best. We'll go through the program fairly quickly that way, and then at the end we can talk more about your specific concerns, okay? So, Bats, Myth, and Reality. You know, the world today on Earth would not be like it is today if we didn't have bats in the environment. 70% of the bats on Earth eat insects, and today biologists know that there's 1,332 different species of bats on Earth. You know, just about 15 or 20 short years ago, there were only 700 named species. And in 20 years, we have almost doubled the number of bat species that we have been able to discover. Now, a part of that is due to our increased ability with technology. We now can use Doppler radar, and we can use GPS and telemetry. We even have some biologists investigating the ways to use unmanned vehicles, drones. Some of you might call them drones that could fly potentially with bat colonies to track their movements, their migrations. We've learned a lot about bats with the increase of our technology, and that's really helped us discover some of these species that we were previously unaware of. We have bats that look like this, little foxes. These are typically fruit bats. Here's another example of a little golden-colored fruit bat. These bats always eat fruit or flower nectar, and they usually live in the tropical zone around the equatorial belt. And the reason for that is because that's where the vast majority of diversity in plants occurs on Earth. There's more kinds of fruits and fruiting trees and shrubs in those parts of the world than anywhere else on Earth. We're going to see those lights go on and off a little, so stay with me. That isn't me. So these bats, we see a lot of these bats in the equatorial zone. Now, here in North America, we don't have fruit-eating bats. We only have insect-eating bats. We have 47 species of insect bats in North America. We have 13 of those species that live year-round right here in Florida. And all of them eat bugs. And boy, that's good for Florida, because we sure do have a lot of insects. Let's talk about this interesting little fellow here. This is a Chapin's bat, and he actually has a crest of hair. If you've ever had a mohawk, you were copying this bat, and you probably didn't even know it. This is the original mohawk, as far as we know, in Mother Nature's world. This is a little male. Only the males have this big shock of hair on their heads, and we think it's because the lady bats think it's mighty attractive. I sometimes explain this phenomenon and say to people, think about your teenage son. The weird things teenagers do to attract other teenagers. I was there. I used to do it. So this is one of those kind of oddities in the natural world. This bat has a really short, blunt nose because he doesn't need a big, long nose. He doesn't stick it into flowers or eat fruit. He eats bugs. And if he had a really long nose, that nose would probably get in the way of his ability to eat insects. So we're going to talk for a minute now about morphology, about bat lifestyles and about bat lives. In the natural world, there are basically two types of bats. Bats belong to a family group called Chiroptera, which means hand wing in Greek. When we see some pictures of wings here in a minute, you'll be able to see how that structure of that wing actually does resemble a human arm and hand. It really does. And this is a very apt name for this group of mammals, hand wing or Chiroptera. Within the family group of Chiroptera, we have two divisions. We have microchiroptera, meaning small bats, and we have megachiroptera, meaning large bats. And typically, the small bats are going to be the insect eaters. There's a couple of exceptions to this general rule, like there always is, but for the most part, all the little teeny bats in the world eat bugs. That's because they have to expend so much energy flying around and chasing their food. Okay? They're burning as many calories as they're consuming on a given night, so they don't get very big. Mother Nature keeps them small so they can live in this environment. On the other hand, we have the fruit-eating bats, which are the megachiropterans, or large bats. They tend to not have to chase their food. When's the last time you saw a banana running away from you? Right? Or an orange tree was, you know, picked up its skirts and hauled butt because you were trying to pick an orange. This just doesn't happen, right? Trees don't run away. And so when these large bats fly to a tree and they start to eat the fruit, they don't have to expend much energy. They can fly to a fig tree in the forest with all the figs more or less ripe at the same time, and he can sit there all night long and just stuff his face full of figs. And because these bats consume sugary fruits, they tend to have a high carbohydrate diet, and Mother Nature lets them get big. This happens with people too, I've discovered. So let's take a look at this little bat's face. This is a micro bat. It's an insect eating species. What about those eyes? You think this bat can see very well? The fact is that he can see really well, and we have found out that the first myth I want to bust is that bats are blind. They are not. Never have been and never were. We just presumed that because they fly at night, and we knew they used echolocation. So we thought, okay, they have this wonderful ability to echolocate and see through sound waves in darkness, and they only come out at night, so therefore they must not need vision, so they must be blind. Well, nothing could be farther from the truth. We've learned a lot about bat vision in the last 20 years, and most of the species we've been able to actually test can see better than we can, especially in low-level light. That's where their eyesight really, really shines. We see this tiny little bat in his tiny little eyes, and we think, oh, he can't see. He's got hair in his eyes and everything. That's not true. This bat sees really well. And in fact, many species, including many of the bat species here in Florida, will emerge before it gets completely dark, and they'll use their vision as well as their echolocation when they're hunting. So it's a double whammy for the insects. We have bats that look like this with great big ears. This looks more like a rabbit, if you ask me, but it's truly a bat. And it has a great big nose leaf, and that big nose leaf on the front of that bat's face is an adaptation to help this bat hear better. You'd think with those great huge ears he'd hear really well, but this is like the frosting on the cake. This big nose leaf, when he echolocates and the sound wave sends an echo back to his ears, it strikes this nose leaf on the front of his face and directs additional sound waves, higher frequency calls, back up into his ears. So these bats can really, really hear things that we can only even begin to imagine. Most of our echolocating species echolocate between 20 and 120 kilohertz. We, most people, can't hear anything over about 10 or 12. So we really can't hear these bats out there at night. We really can't. And it's probably a good thing because it's extremely loud. Their calls are extremely loud and shrill. And if you think the night is silent, you're mistaken. It's just that we have crummy hearing. We can't hear what's going on out there. And it's a good thing. Here we have a picture of a bat that's called a Comerson's bat, and he's got a really strange face. Again, this is a bat that has developed over eons of time, has evolved in its habitat to develop these kinds of facial features that help him hear really well. We have this guy. This is a sword-nosed bat. You can see how tall the nose sword is on that structure on the front of his face. It looks like a third ear. It's actually a soft, supple piece of skin with cartilage in it, much like our ears. If you reach up and touch the outside of your ears right here on the top part of your ear, you know that it's really flexible. And the cartilage that's in our ear helps it hold its shape when we're not sleeping on it funny or putting on a hat. But when we want to move our ear around, it's not a problem. We can do that very easily. And that's true with these nose leaves as well. They aren't rigid structures. They're somewhat supple. The bat can see really well around them, but it helps the bat hear. It's like having an extra set of ears out there. We see this in some of the bats that hunt, particularly in high, dense vegetation, because the echoes can get really lost in vegetation. All right, it's not a clear line of sight. Here we have another example of a bat that has a big nose leaf with lots of wrinkles, great big long pointed ears. These animals look odd to us, but honestly, after you start to learn about bats, you realize that these are all adaptations to their lifestyle and their environment. It also is adaptation many times to what they eat. So interesting creatures, but certainly not something that we should fear. The world's got a lot of bats in it, 1,332 species, and this is the smallest one. This is, so far as we know today at least, this is the smallest one. Let me put that in there because it could change tomorrow. This bat is actually nicknamed the bumblebee bat, but it's called the kitty's hog-nosed bat. And this bat lives in deep jungles, deep in thick vegetation in Southeast Asia, most notably in Thailand, but we think also in Vietnam and some of the other parts of Southeast Asia. You know, we had a war, quite an extended period of war there in Southeast Asia from the 1940s until just the late 1970s. I mean, there were many nations involved in the Vietnam conflict, you know, before we got there. And a lot of the wildlife suffered as dramatically as the people did. So this bat was only discovered about 10 or 12 years ago because that was really when we were able to get into some of these jungles, when we could get in there and start studying some of the wildlife, start setting up camera traps and looking with infrared photography to see what kind of species were left, if any, because it was a really violent time. A good portion of that part of the world has grown back over. Jungles repair themselves quickly. And we now think this bat is probably fairly rare. We don't think it's endangered, but we think it's probably pretty rare. This bat has a wingspan of about 3 to 3.5 inches when it's fully extended and flying. And I know about 3 nights ago at my house, I killed a roach bigger than that. It wasn't in my house, fortunately. It was out on the porch. My cat found it for me. That's a wonderful thing about cats. They find bugs for you, don't they? This little bat is really tiny. It's not only the smallest bat in the world, it's also the tiniest mammal. This bat has it nicknamed the bumblebee bat because his body is about the size of a quarter or about the size of one of these little bumblebees we see buzzing around, the Bombus species of bumblebees. This bat has a really small furry body. It does eat insects. We know that it eats tiny little insects because it has a little mouth. And if you go home later this evening and you put a penny in the palm of your hand, just balancing a penny in your hand, you will know that that's the adult weight of this bat. That bat weighs, as an adult, about as much as that penny weighs in your hand. Really tiny, small little bat. And of course, the world is a pretty balanced place when we allow it to be. This is a picture of one of our larger flying foxes, a fruit bat. This is again in Southeast Asia, and there are sects of monks and Buddhist monk sects that actually have adopted some of these bats because they were becoming so endangered at one point. People in some of these nations hunt these bats and eat them as food. Well, I have to tell you that the largest bat in the world has a 6-foot wingspan and is right around 38 inches tall, but he only weighs 4 pounds. So there's not a whole lot of meat on these animals. They're mostly wings, okay? Even though they look rather large in size. This is a young fruit bat that this guy is holding here, and he's showing an example of one of the larger species in Southeast Asia. These bats really needed the protection of the monks and the help, and what the monks do in return is they harvest some of the guano out of the caves, and then they sell it and provides fertilizer for the farms in the area. You may not know it, but bat guano, which is the technical name for poop, but bat guano is actually the world's greatest fertilizer for plants and especially for farm-type plants, gardens and food plants. It's a cold fertilizer. That means you can use it as soon as it comes out of the bat, you can use it right on the plant. Unlike, say, horse or steer manure, which has to be composted because it's very high in urea and a lot of nitrogen. Not so with bat guano. It's more or less dry and granular when it comes out of the bat. A little bit like coffee grounds. It builds up very slowly on the ground. And if you really want to put a bat house up and harvest guano for your garden, I always recommend you put the bat house in the middle of your garden. That way it's there where you need it. You don't have to haul it around. You just go out a couple times a year and kick it, and it's where you want it. It's painless gardening. The bats will come out of the bat house every evening and eat all the bugs flying through your yard. You will have the most beautiful tomatoes and the most untouched lettuce on the block, I guarantee it. These animals are very good at protecting food supplies, and that's a big value to humans. So, this is a little mouse-tailed bat, and you know, I threw this in here because I think this bat looks like a mouse. What do you think? Are bats mice with wings? No, they are not. For a long time, this is another myth, for many, many hundreds of years, people all over the world thought that these animals were just rodents with wings, that they were somehow vermin, that they were disease-ridden, that they were dirty, that they would bring other insects into your house or into your property if you allowed bats to live anywhere near you. There were so many superstitions attached to this poor animal that honestly many of these species nearly have become extinct. We're fighting an uphill battle here with education because the number one predator worldwide of bats is human beings. And the number one reason for that is just plain old ignorance, something we can do something about, which is why I threw my tools down and started talking. A lot of talking. This little mouse-tailed bat, even though it's called a mouse-tailed bat, sorry, it's not a member of the rodent family. Through genetic testing and a lot of research, we have discovered that these mammals, these little flighted mammals, the only mammals on Earth that have ever evolved flight, are most closely related to primates. Find that surprising? Not really. Let me tell you a little bit about how a bat's put together. A bat has an arm, an upper arm, an elbow, a wrist, and a shoulder, and fingers that are very similar to other primates. It has an opposing thumb. Female bats have only two nipples, like other kinds of primates, not a row of nipples down each side like dogs and cats and pigs. Okay? They have two nipples, like other primates. Even if they have multiple babies, they still have to feed both all those babies with just those two breasts. We have other things about these animals that as mammals that pointed sort of, we should have known that they were primates. They spend a lot of time in trees. They're wonderful climbers. They're arboreal. We even believe some of these small bats that live in trees have possibly got prehensile type tails, that their tails can actually help balance them and they can possibly cling to things. I know the bat in my pocket here, the Brazilian free tail, who's native to Florida. When I hold her, she often wraps her tail around my finger. Now, is she being absolutely prehensile? I don't know. I haven't asked her. But it's possible, and that is a behavior that we observe in lots of species. The other thing that we know about these animals is that all of the genitalia on both the males and the females is external, just like on other mammals that are in the primate family. Okay, so very, very easy to tell the males from the females in these species. So there are some clues that we didn't really pick up on early on. We kind of were waiting until the genetic testing could be completed, but it's not really a surprise. Now that we know, it's really not surprising to me that these animals are actually members closely related to the primate family. Here we have an example of a fruit-eating bat. So this guy has no tail. All right, he doesn't really need a tail for balance. He doesn't really require a tail for navigation because he's not an acrobatic flyer. Once again, he's not chasing bananas through the air. He simply flies to the tree. Flight for him is a transportation mechanism. It's a form of commuting. So he really doesn't require much of a tail because the tail is used heavily by insect-eating bats to capture bugs. This bat actually is a pretty good picture of the wing structure. Here you can see the arm, and the thumb that's sticking up on the leading edge of the wing and the four fingers that make up the structure of that membrane. The wing membrane itself is soft, supple, elastic skin. It's warm, it's highly vascular, it's really elastic, it's very strong, and yet it's very light. And if a bat gets a tear in the wing membrane, which frequently happens, or gets a cut or, you know, knocks it against a branch and breaks open part of the wing, it actually does heal very quickly, just like other parts of skin do, just like our hand would if we got a nick or a cut. So this is really skin. It's not leathery. It's not dead. It's not, some kind of an odd, strange, freaky material. It's actually skin, just like the skin on the inside of your wrist. I have one bat with me tonight that actually allows me on occasions to open her wings so you can see it. Most of our captive bats, because they can't fly, have had wing injuries, and it's uncomfortable for me to open their wings, so we don't do it. And you'll ask me, you'll say, why are there, where's the wings? Where are the wings? They're there, but they're rolled up tightly along the sides of the arms, and we'll see that when I show the bats. But I will be able to show you one wing membrane, and you'll see what this is. We have a lot of colors in bats. There's a lot of diversity. Look, 1,332 kinds of bats, and boy, every one of them looks different. And there's very few that are actually black and brown. We've got a lot of coloration here in bats. We have a golden winged bat here with silver fur from Africa. It has an insect-eating bat. Here we have one of our larger fruit bats. This is one of the pterapus. This is named after the pterodactyl family because originally they thought that they looked like flying pterodactyls. And this is a bat that hangs upside down in the open in vegetation. You can see here he's got great big eyes and wraps his wings around himself, and he's got a golden fur collar around his neck. Here we have a picture of Dr. Merlin Tuttle, who's the founder of Bat Conservation International, which is headquartered right now in Austin, Texas. You know, I always have to say, this man recently retired from the organization and is now an advisor, and he's traveling the world, still continuing to study bats. He started studying bats when he was 15 years old, and he was a Boy Scout. And where he was growing up, there was a cave that he knew there were bats in it. He went into the bat cave and started observing the bats and drawing pictures of them and taking notes and photographs. And this man is probably the most influential biologist that's ever come out in the last 40 years for bats. And honestly, a guy named Merlin probably was destined to study bats, I have to say. You know, he probably didn't have much of a choice. But here, Dr. Tuttle's actually holding a banana for this small fruit bat. And this fruit bat has been trained to come fly to him and sit on his hand and eat the banana. These are smart animals. The point of this slide is to tell you how clever these animals are. Just like all mammals, they have fairly large brains. They can problem solve. They're adaptable, highly adaptable creatures. They live fairly long lives. But what we didn't know until recently is they live the longest lives of any mammals in their size class. It's very common for Florida species to live 20 years. We have other species around the world that live in excess of 40 years. And some of the really large fruit bats in the Pacific may live 60 or 70 years. We really don't know yet. We haven't been studying them long enough to give us a good picture. So that's all yet to be determined. But we know they live a really long life. We know that for the most part, their life is healthy. They have really large brains, larger than any other mammal in their size class. And they reproduce more slowly than any other mammal in their size class. These bats typically have one baby a year, and that's it. Just one. The downside of that is that all of those pups that were born this year, let's take just Florida as an example, all the baby bats, which we call pups, that were born last spring, 50% of them, fully one half, will not live to see their first birthday. They will die because of accidents or predation, 50% of them. So this little Brazilian freetail in my pocket is a female, and if she were in the wild, she might live 17 years. She might have 12 babies in her whole lifetime, and six of them will die before their first birthday. So her contribution to the bat population after a 17-year reproductive life is going to be six bats on average. This is statistically. That's not a very rapid rate of growth, is it? Not a very rapid way of repopulating. And you might not know it, but up until fairly recently, it was legal to kill bats here in Florida. If you got bats in your attic, or they were in a horse stall, or in the school, or some other structure, and you didn't want them there, and you needed to get rid of them, it was perfectly legal to call an exterminator who would come out and gas and kill the bats and haul them away. When we started understanding how long it takes for these animals to reproduce, and how long they live, we realized that if you take 500 bats out of the environment, and that's a modest-sized colony of free-tailed bats, if you take 500 bats out of the environment, it can take 100 years to replace those bats. And if you do that at every third or fifth house all over Florida, boy, now you're really impacting the populations, and populations have, in fact, decreased dramatically in the last 40 or 50 years. Part of it's from habitat loss, part of it's from us killing them when they come into our buildings, and of course the other part of it is the toxins and the poisons that we're using in the environment. It's starting to impact the bat population. So they're up against a lot of things. And what we want you to understand from this program is that they're not vermin and they're not dangerous. In fact, they're very cute. You can see this guy. He's actually getting ready to be fed. And look at, he's all excited. Just like dogs and cats, they get all excited. My husband gets excited at dinner time. My husband gets this look on his face and starts salivating and licking his lips. Ooh, spaghetti and meatballs. You know, it's true with these mammals. They can be trained, they're really clever, and they do get excited at mealtime like this. Now this little bat was actually getting ready to eat some figs, and this is what he looked like after he ate some. He is a figgy piggy. This bat eats so many figs, he stuffs so much food in his mouth, there isn't even room for his tongue anymore, so he sticks his tongue out. And I don't know, his eyes even seem to be bulging, if you ask me. This bat's really, we have called this bat, this photograph, the figgy piggy, because it's just, it's so appropriate for this little animal. And they really do enjoy their food, I must say. This is a little fruit-eating bat, a Wahlberg's fruit bat. Here we have a picture of one of our insect-eating bats. This is a big-eared bat. And you can see here, this insect-eating bat looks quite a bit different than the fruit bat. Very different kinds of features, very different kinds of food. We have some species of bats that live solitary lives. Most bat species build colonies. They like to live in family groups. They're very social. They're socially connected to each other. They have their babies within the family group. All of them kind of cohabitate and they raise the pups all at the same time. We even have some evidence that suggests that if something happens to a mother bat and she doesn't return to the roost to feed her pup, that other bats in the colony will adopt her baby and take it on. We see this altruistic behavior in several species of bats, including vampires, by the way. And then there's the lifestyle like this one, the solitary bats. And we have five or so bats in Florida, bat species that are solitary. They don't live in family groups. They live by themselves. They prefer to be alone. This is a silver-haired bat, and it's commonly found roosting in the old growth bark of pine trees. You know, when pine trees, particularly longleaf pines, get really, really old, the bark gets really spread out. It gets what we call rugose. It's very lumpy and bumpy, and it's all wrinkled and rippled. And these bats just wiggle right down inside those little cracks of that bark, and honestly, you could walk right up to it and look at that bat and not see it. Bats are shy, gentle animals, and their only defense is camouflage. Their only defense from predators. They don't have claws and big teeth to defend themselves from raccoons and snakes and owls that eat them. Their only defense is to hide. And typically an animal that's defenseless like that and is shy is also very gentle and unassuming. Let's face it, if you're really shy and you can't defend yourself, you're not going to jump out there and get in everybody's face and be a bully, are you? Okay, so these are really really shy animals. This is a picture of one of our bats here in Florida, another species that lives in trees that's a solitary bat. This is Lassiurus cinerus, and this is commonly referred to as the hoary bat. Now, I'll spell that H-O-A-R-Y as in hoarfrost. And people from up north will know what hoarfrost is. It's one of the early frosts that dusts the tops of plants, and it looks like, just like a dusting of frost. And you can see this bat's fur here is just frosted on the tips with little white hair, little white frost, and that's how it got that name. Here's another example of a bat. This is a little myotis that lives commonly under bridges in small colony groups and is frequently found in bat houses. Really small little insect-eating bat. These are big pictures of really small bats. Here we have a high-tech exclusion device. Now that it is illegal to kill bats, if you get these little guys, these Brazilian freetails, in your house somewhere, up in the attic, you can exclude them, but you must do it humanely. You cannot kill them. There are fines and it's expensive. We're really serious in Florida about protecting these bats. And these Brazilian freetails are coming out underneath this high-tech exclusion device called bird netting and duct tape. Everybody that's here could do this, all right? Assuming you can get on a ladder and you can duct tape a piece of window screen or bird netting loosely over the opening where the bats come in and out, and leave it hanging down nice and low. You see the bats come out of the building and they drop straight down the wall, drop down and fly away. This is the way they need to get airborne. What happens then in the morning after all the bats leave, most of the bats will come out, some stay in the building, so you need to leave this exclusion device up, this high-tech equipment. You need to leave it up for 5 or 6 or 10 consecutive nights to make sure all the bats are out of the building before you pull it down and fix the building. So your responsibility is to get the bats out safely and fix the building. If you don't, if you think, oh, well, that's it, all done, pull down the netting, I assure you, I promise you, I guarantee 100% that those bats will return that very night and they'll get right back in the building. They have a very high degree of roost loyalty, which is good and bad, and it depends on how you look at it. So what happens in the morning is the bats return, they try to get back into the roost, they land on top of the netting and they can't get back in. They cannot fly up underneath the netting and get into the structure. They're going to land on the outside and try to crawl through like they always have, and they won't be able to gain access to the house. So this is a really easy and simple way for homeowners to exclude bats. When you do this, if you find yourself in this position and you have to exclude a colony, it's advisable to take the next step and put a bat house up in advance of your exclusion, because that's going to give those bats someplace permanent to go and live. Instead of chasing this little colony of bats from your attic to maybe your neighbor's house three houses down, who also has a hole in their roof, and passing the problem on, you can actually provide a more permanent solution by building and putting up a well-made bat house. And most of the time, about 90% of the time, in exclusions like this, the bats do move into the bat house. It works really, really well. So it's worth the effort to do that. It keeps the bats in the neighborhood, everybody benefits from the insect control, and then you're not chasing little bats all over the neighborhood. Here's a colony of free-tailed pups. This is what the babies look like. They can't fly until they're between 8 and 12 weeks old. So during baby season, which is between April 15th, tax day, how could I forget that, April 15th and August 15th, for that 6-month period in the summer, you may not, for any reason, exclude bats from your attic or a building. You must leave them alone, because babies are in there and mothers are raising their pups and the babies can't fly. And if you did that exclusion and you separated the mothers from the pups, all these pups are going to die in your attic, and boy, will that stink. Literally. In addition to that, the next morning when those mothers try to get back in that building to feed their pups, they're going to bloody themselves trying to get back in. They are dedicated, committed mothers. In every sense of the word, just like human mothers are. So you do not, it's illegal to do any kind of exclusion or harass or move bats at all between April 15th and August 15th. All right, so kind of keep that in mind. That's a Florida regulation. Here's a little picture of a little myotis who's actually echolocating. What do you hear pumping around there? He's got his tongue out. You know, this is a common thing. A lot of these pictures you're going to see of these bats, they're flying, or you see pictures of them, they've got their mouths open. It's because they're echolocating. If their mouths aren't open, they can't make a sound because they're using vocal cords like we do when we talk. Okay? Here's what a great photograph of one of our bats eating out west, eating a katydid or a leafhopper. You can see that insect's almost as big as the bat, very nearly. Most bat species in North America, all the insect eaters that we have, which is all of them, will emerge every evening and they'll eat their own weight more or less, a little more or a little less depending on whether they're pregnant, lactating, or just a male. Most of them will eat very close to their own weight in insects every single night. So if you think about how much you weigh, tonight when you get out of here, you're going to go over to McDonald's and you're going to order, 180 pounds of bugs, to eat. That would be what you would eat every single night for the rest of your life, which is, in this case, about 20 years. So you can see how having a few bats around can really make a big dent in the insect population. And the kinds of insects that they eat is virtually anything that's out there flying, including all species of mosquitoes. Yay! They don't eat just mosquitoes. Don't put that word in my mouth. They don't eat just mosquitoes, but they eat a lot of mosquitoes, in addition to moths, roaches, spiders, mayflies, caddisflies, termites that swarm 2 or 3 times a year, all kinds of flying ants, all kinds of nighttime flying regular flies, all true bugs. So they eat a whole bunch of different kinds of insects. Just about anything that's outside after dark is on the menu. All right. Here's a picture of an African bat that actually does not hunt flying insects. It can actually hunt ground walking insects. This bat's hearing is so acute, so intensely good, that he can hear the footsteps of this little beetle on the ground. As long as he's within 10 or 12 feet of that beetle, he can hear it walking. That's an amazing set of ears. Here we have a picture of another bat species we have here in Florida, Central Florida and North Florida. This is called an Eastern Red Bat. This is Lassiurus borealis. They're red bats. You can see they're reddish colored. They're very pretty. This is another solitary species of bat. Typically does not live in family groups. They always live by themselves. Here we have an emerging colony of Brazilian free tails, and you know, there wasn't too many hundred years ago, and not even just probably only 50 or 60 years ago, that the scenes like this were fairly common out in the West and also here in Florida. When you saw bats emerging at sunset, they would sometimes, in some places, just completely darken the sky. There were so many bats. Carlsbad Caverns is a very famous place in New Mexico. Many of you have probably been there. I've been there many times. And you know, the bat colony at Carlsbad has dwindled in some cases. Biologists are saying it's dwindled by 70%. Only 30% of the bats that lived in that cave 50 years ago are there today. Why? Well, we have to say that it's probably due to pesticide use and habitat loss. We think that if we're poisoning insects, and we do, we're out there with mosquito control trucks and aerial drops and all kinds of, floating those donuts in the water that kill all the things in the water that would normally eat mosquito larvae like the frogs and the fish and other stuff. We think that this kind of activity has made such a dent in the bat population because if a bat eats a damaged insect that's been poisoned, it could potentially kill the bat, just one poison bug. These animals are highly sensitive to chemicals. They're little and they have an extremely rapid metabolism, so they can be fine 1 minute and dead 30 minutes later. Here we have a picture of some people in Southeast Asia. These are ladies that have gone into the bat caves and they're actually harvesting the guano. You know, there's some small nations, island nations in particular, where they have large bat caves that have been traditionally used for thousands of years by bat colonies. And the guano has built up and built up and built up like you see here. And these ladies go into these cave systems and they harvest the guano and they sell it. And some of these small nations are actually balancing their annual budget selling bat poop to the rest of the world. There's a lot of good things in bat poop. There's a lot of organisms and a lot of bacteria and a lot of different kinds of components in bat guano that we can actually isolate and use, we've discovered, for many things. We have actually figured out that there's a component in some bat guano that can actually be used as a sponge to clean up oil spills. It's a chemical, it attracts the chemical back into the guano. So there's a lot of things in bat guano that probably will help mankind if we can just get them to hang around long enough so we can learn about them. Bats like this eat fish. We do have some fish-eating species in the world. Most of these are in South America. This bat probably has the most finely tuned echolocation. That at least is the belief right now by biologists who are studying this species. We know this bat can detect the fin on this fish that's as fine as a human hair if it sticks up out of the water less than 2 millimeters. Now that's a really, really tiny little ripple on the water. And this bat can find this fish under the water in complete darkness in the jungle without even probably seeing it. So it's really got really finely tuned echolocation. Here we have a picture of a fringe-lipped bat which eats frogs. You can see here he's coming in to get the frog. This bat's really fun. I like this bat because of the wing. Take a look at this fabulous wing. Remember I promised you would see the hand structure? Well, there it is. We have a thumb and four fingers. If you take a look at my hand, and you take a look at that bat wing, you are seeing very much the same bones. The main difference is the length of the bone. My little finger is laughingly the longest one on him, okay? But you can see the thumb sticking out with the wrist, and it's the hand, and the index finger, the middle finger, the ring finger, and the small finger, and they're all there for you to see. This is the common structure of bat wings worldwide. Despite what the species is or what it eats, how large or small it is, this is the basic structure of a bat's wing. Okay, and it really makes it unique, and it makes it a wonderful flyer. And yes, you know, it is Halloween time, and we do need to talk about vampire bats. There are three species of vampire bats in the world. All three of them live in Central America, and a couple species live down in South America, but they're all three predominantly in jungles. All right, I think I have a slide here of, there's where they live. Does that look like a place you want to go on vacation?
No.
It's really not a great place to go visit. They live deep in pristine jungles, and the jungles are so dense with foliage that these bats have pretty much stopped flying. All three vampire species have pretty much given up flight. They can fly, but they're really bad at it. They spend a lot more time crawling around, rummaging through the foliage on the ground, looking for nesting birds, rummaging and crawling up the trees and right down the branches looking for birds, because it turns out that all three species, we believe, prefer the blood of birds. They do eat blood, It is a blood eater, but they don't really like mammal blood. It turns out they prefer bird blood. So what happens when we have people go into the pristine jungle? Okay, here we have a vampire bat actually kind of walking across the forest floor rather than flying. What happens when we go into this pristine jungle with our bulldozers and we pull out all the trees and for several, maybe square miles, we take all the trees out, we get all the vegetation down, we burn it all. What happens to the birds? They disappear, don't they? The birds don't hang around. They go out and they recede back further into the jungle. And when this little vampire bat comes out to get a blood meal, he comes crawling out of his roost and there's no birds and there's no trees. And everything in his world has changed. Everything. His only food supply has been removed. And because he can't fly very far or very well, he can't follow the birds a mile away into the jungle and start feeding on birds. So he will go back to his roost hungry. And on the second night, he'll come out and look for something to eat and he won't find birds and he'll go back to his roost hungry again. And typically on the third or fourth night of these bats not being able to find something to eat, they will die, literally starve to death if they don't get blood. And that is when we sometimes see these bat species biting and taking a blood meal from a mammal like a goat or a cow or a horse that's in the field. It's very, very unusual. It doesn't happen very often, and it's always because basically it's an aftermath of destroying the habitat and taking the trees down and removing the birds. So despite the fact that they're a little creepy, and I admit anything that eats blood is a little weird, they are not dangerous to human beings, never have been dangerous to human beings, and yet millions and millions of bats worldwide are killed needlessly because people believe they're vampires. The truth is there's only three species and they don't live everywhere. They only live in Central America. So unless you're there, you will not know, it will not be a vampire bat. I have people every year call me here in Florida and say, I have a vampire bat on my pool screen. Because they got on the internet and they looked something up and that looks just like a vampire bat to them. Well, you know, there's a lot more to identifying a species than looking at a photograph on the internet. Be aware of that. So many species look very much alike. So it's not a vampire bat. Rest assured, it's not going to bite you or your child or your dog. And you don't need to freak out about it. If you go to Central America, you probably won't find these animals. They are considered endangered by many, many biologists now. There's another picture of that jungle. Here we have a picture of a bat that's actually a pollinator. Look at this bat hovering over this little flower. They stick their nose in the flower. They get pollen all over their faces. And when they go to the next flower to get a nectar meal, they're transferring pollen back and forth to flowers and creating new plants. This is how plants reproduce. We all know pollination's important. But you know, you may not know that there's over 60 or 70 different products right now in the world that are used by humans for just about everything, from rope to food supplies that are pollinated by bats. Specific types of plants that only bats pollinate, like wild bananas. They're, far as we know, the only pollinator of a wild banana is a bat. We have a picture of one, I think, here coming up. Here we have a little fruit-eating bat. Here we have another picture of a bat that's harvesting a different type of fruit. This is a Gambian bat in Africa. This is harvesting a bunch of little pieces of fruit off of a tree, and he's going to take it off of the tree and then fly away with it. That's him flying off with it. What we've learned by observing these fruit-eating bats is they typically will harvest the fruit and then fly to another location to eat it. Because the predators, the jaguars and the things that eat these bats, the snakes and other kinds of predators, that sit in the fruit tree waiting for these bats to come get the fruit, know where to wait. And the bats have figured out that tree is a source of food, but it also is a dangerous place to eat your food because there's a lot of predators hanging around. So they'll take the fruit typically to some other place and eat it. And then, after they consume this meal, usually it passes through them in about 15 or 20 minutes. There's some species that takes even less time than that. And once their meal passes through them and they defecate, they go poop, right? They fly away, and as they're flying to the next tree because they're hungry again, they're pooping little seeds all across the field, and they are dispersing seeds. We used to believe that birds were the number one seed disperser on Earth, and it's true that birds do spread a lot of seeds around. I mean, think about Brazilian peppers. You know, we have a lot of those from birds, don't we? But the truth is that bat species worldwide disperse a lot more seeds than birds do. because they have a tendency to fly completely straight across a clear-cut field or a slashed and burned forest, whereas birds will stay around the outer edge in the vegetation line. Bats don't care. They fly right through the center, and they poop all those plants all the way across. And we know that many pioneer species, the original species of plants that come in and restore a habitat very early on, are planted by bats. So it's an important thing that we see happening. Here we have a bat that's consuming a fig. He'll eat two or three of these figs all at once and process that food, and look at all the seeds. You know how seeds there are in figs. Here's another little bat eating a fig. Wild figs seem to be a favorite food for many of these fruit bats. And here's a picture of what we do to the forest. And this is where the bats replant many of the plants that we were just talking about. They fly across these clear-cut zones and reestablish many of the fruit trees and other kinds of vegetation as well. This is a little Gambian bat just showing the flight path and the flight pattern. You know, I'll say one word here just real briefly about fruit bats. We think some of them echolocate, but we know they don't need to echolocate to find their food. We think that if they have an echolocation ability, it's purely used for navigation. It helps them in their commute during the nighttime from one point to another. We also know that fruit bats tend to be a lot more active even during daylight hours than insect-eating bats, because fruit, once again, doesn't come out just at night, does it? So fruit-eating species tend to be more active during daylight hours, and this is why you see these species displayed at the zoos and the ecological parks and all the other places where they display bats. They are not native to North America. The bats at Disney are pretty, but they are not North American bats, so don't be misled by that. Here we have a cluster of golden collared bats living in the open, out in the trees. This is where most bat species live. Here you see some, it's a little hard to see these guys. They're actually they're all clustered together in this great big kind of burned out tree here. And here is one that's harvesting a fairly large piece of fruit. And here's the Lyell's fox, flying fox, and they actually do darken the sky pretty readily where they live in Africa. Quite a few of them. They fly during the day as well as at night. Here we have a little Jamaican fruit bat who's got an allspice berry in his mouth, and he's a fairly small little fruit bat. Look at his cute little toes. I love that picture. He's going to fly over and eat an allspice berry. Here's another lovely picture of that wonderful wing. This is also a little Jamaican fruit bat, and he's harvesting what's called a tropical almond. And this bat will eat the fruit on the fleshy part of the outside of the almond, and then he'll spit the shell out on the ground, and of course that will grow a whole new almond. And so these bats are not only providing additional food for their future and their future generations, but also for the people and other animals that live in these places. Here's a picture of some of the products that we know that bats either directly or indirectly provide for humans. Everything from tequila to life preservers. Now, you might scratch your head about the life preserver, and you know, originally life preservers were stuffed with kapok, which is a buoyant fiber from the kapok tree. Anybody ever seen a kapok tree? There used to be a lot of them in South Florida. And that is something that still is used in some places today. Also, the tequila, I have to say the only pollinator that we have in North America kind of goes between Mexico and the borderlands in the desert southwest. It pollinates large cactuses. Our cacti, and that particular bottle of tequila is a direct result of the blue agave cactus. We all know that the blue agave makes tequila, and this little bat pollinates that cactus, and as far as we know, it's the only pollinator of that cactus. So I urge you to enjoy your tequila responsibly, have a margarita once in a while or a shot, but every time you do it, I want you to think of that bat, because that is exactly who is providing that for us. Balsa wood, sisal fibers, we have papayas and mangoes, cashews, cloves, almonds, breadfruit, guavas, you name it. We have all kinds of plants up there that are directly either pollinated or protected by bats. Here we have a picture of a bat that's going to a flower to eat nectar, and I'll just let these run for a second. We have some really nice pictures of pollinating bat species. This one has a little nose leaf on it. Here we have the bat pollinator for the wild bananas. You can see the small bananas forming above on the stalk, and this is the flower spike here, and this little bat has white pollen all over its face. Yum, yum. Aw, cute little bat face. I like that picture. Here we have a little pollinating bat. This is another one that gets inside of balsa. I think this is a balsa tree that's being pollinated. Look how small these bats are. They crawl right down inside of these white flowers. This is a picture of some bats emerging from a bat cave. There are some species of bats that live in caves, but I think I said earlier on that when we went looking for bats, we discovered that only about 5% of the caves in the world actually support bats, which means that a lot of bats are not living in caves. They're living in vegetation and foliage, both dead and alive. Here we have a picture of a bat coming in. This is an unusual, this is a Wahlberg's bat, unusual picture of this wonderful flower. The bat's going to fly in. He's going to grab a hold of the flower that's holding, the round part that's hanging down, and that's the part where all the pollen is. Take a look. He's holding on to that ball. He's getting up into the nectar and the deep part of the plant, eating the nectar. But in the process, his entire body, all of the hair on his abdomen, is being dusted liberally with the pollen from this plant. When he leaves and goes to the next flower on another tree or the same tree, he'll mix those pollen grains and create fruit with seeds so that this plant can reproduce. Here we have another picture of a Wahlberg's bat enjoying a nice, I'm not sure what that is. It looks like it might be a mango. Yeah, looks like a mango. Oh, yes, it is mangoes. Now, a lot of people in the Caribbean and other places in the world, many of the farmers, used to believe that bats were competing with them for the fruit crops. There are places in Australia where there was actually a bounty on fruit bats because the farmers felt that the bats were eating all the fruit. They were killing them with shotguns and killing them with all kinds of things. They did the same thing with cockatoos and lots of other flock-type birds. Truth is, we have learned through observation that bats do not eat unripened fruit. You can see here that fruit typically, when it's harvested, is harvested when it's green. When it is unripened, and this is so it can be packed in boxes and shipped by plane or boat to another location, and when it arrives at that location, it'll be more or less ripe enough to eat. It won't be tasty, but it'll be look ripe to our eyes. If we allowed the fruit to ripen on the tree and then picked it, it would be rotted by the time it got to its destination. So this is a very common practice all over the world with agriculture. Even here in the United States, everything's picked before it's really ripe. It's packed in boxes and crates, and it's shipped to its final destination. What we discovered is bats don't eat unripened fruit. When the pickers go through the fields and in the orchards or in the groves, they pull down all of the fruit from the trees. They often miss some of the fruit, especially any of the fruit that's way high up in the tree canopy. And because that fruit's still hanging there, it on the tree will ripen. And what these bats do is they come in after the pickers are gone, they wait for the fruit to get ripe, and they eat that fruit. And when they eat that ripened fruit instead of this green fruit, like this little guy's really enjoying that juicy mango, what we see is they're actually saving farmers a lot of hassle because rotten fruit, when it hits the ground, is going to attract insects. Little fruit flies like this that do a lot of damage to fruit. And by the bats eating the fruit that the pickers miss, they're actually keeping the orchard clean. They're minimizing the insect population for the next year's crop. Once farmers started to understand this relationship between the bats and the fruit, they quit killing them. They went, oh yeah, that makes sense. And we've seen a great increase in fruit production, and these bats are now in many places protected because the farmers understand the value of them. Here we have a picture of a Brazilian freetail who's in my hand. We'll look at her up close in a minute. This Brazilian freetail is probably the most commonly seen bat in Florida. Despite the fact that it has Brazilian in its name, it is native to North America. It has a little tail hanging down past the tail membrane. You can see it right there. And big round ears. It is a really neat little bat. They're very, very clever. This is probably my favorite species of bat. We've been studying this bat for a long time. This is a bat that's been in rehab that people have been observing and working with in the United States for 30 or so years. And we've learned a lot about this particular species, and it's really an interesting animal. But we do know that they're big colony builders, and these are the kinds of bats, if you put a bat house up, that you're going to get in your bat house. Not these. These are little fruit bats. These are Gambian fruit bats, and here we have a mother with her pup. That's her baby hanging on the front. Now, I'll say this about these bats. They are wonderful mothers, and they love their babies, because every single bat, a single birth like this, when they are born, they weigh 30% of their mother's weight. So in human terms, because that's how we have to think about things, right? So we understand it. In human terms, that is like a 120-pound woman having a 36-pound baby. That's a big baby. A huge investment biologically and in every other way, in the next generation. These are very good mothers and they're committed to their pups. So I like this picture because the pup's nearly as big as the mother and it's still nursing. Here we have a picture of a cave system. You know, bats in northern latitudes do need to have a survival strategy when the insects die back. Some places can be insect-free because of the winters for five, six, seven, 8 months. In those situations, bats will go into hibernation, into cave systems. We will see cave systems like this that have literally thousands, tens of thousands, or millions of bats roosting in them. This actually is a picture of Bracken Cave. These are Brazilian free tails. This is Bracken Cave in West Central Texas. And this bat cave is really the grandmother cave of them all, honestly. This is one of the largest bat caves in the world. We think it's probably got more bats in it than any other cave. And in fact, right now, this is the largest concentration of mammals anywhere on Earth in one spot. There's more bats in this cave than there are people in any of the largest cities in the world that you can name. There's about 25 million bats in that cave. Every evening they emerge like this. They start coming out before it even gets dark. You can see it's fairly light still, usually around 5 in the evening or so during the summer, 5 or 6 o'clock before it gets dark. These bats start emerging. They come out in three distinct waves of bats because there's so many of them, they kind of take turns. And as they emerge, they will all kind of be in ribbons and they'll fly in formation and they'll hang around at fairly high altitudes waiting for everyone in their squadron, so to speak, to get out of the cave. And then they'll go and fly off to their hunting grounds. This particular colony of bats has been clocked on Doppler radar. We see it on Doppler radar emerging from the colony, from the cave. We know this species of bat can fly at 10,000 feet in altitude and at 65 miles an hour. We see it happening all the time. And because of the high altitude flight and the high speed at which they can navigate, we know that these bats fan out over three or four states every night when they start to hunt. And this single colony of bats, the USDA has put a price tag on the value for farmers of $3.7 billion a year in insects. This one colony of bats saves farmers in those four states over $3 billion a year in crop loss. That's amazing. That's a lot of money. So they're very, very important to the environment. Here we have another kind of view of bats emerging from a different kind of a cave system. Usually it doesn't have to be a big round cave. It can be a crack in the wall, more or less. Here we have some more fruit bats, Lyle's foxes up in the trees. And they, once again, you'll see it's daylight. Their eyes are open. They're not afraid of the dark. So that's another myth busted. Bats are not afraid of sunlight. Their eyes are very well adjusted to daylight as well as darkness. And many bat species can be active during the day and they're perfectly healthy. Many times people will tell you if you see a bat out flying during the day, it must be sick or it must be dangerous, it might be diseased, something's wrong with it. It's just not true. Lots of bat species fly around during the day because they're thirsty. They're roosting and they're asleep and they wake up and they're thirsty. They want to go get a drink of water. So they'll come out of the roost, they'll fly over to a swimming pool or a body of water, they'll fly over the water, they'll get five or six little drinks of water back and forth and they'll turn around and go back into the roost. That isn't a sick bat, that's a thirsty bat. If you happen to see a bat lying on the ground, now that's a sick or injured bat. A bat that's flying is perfectly healthy, so don't be misled by some of this misinformation that's widely spread around our communities. Again, Lyle's bats flying through the forest and at night starting to look for things to eat. And unfortunately, we have people who eat bats. This is a pile of very, very small insect-eating bats that have been harvested from a cave. They're being sorted and cooked, and they'll be sent to a market. There are some cultures that engage in this bushmeat activity. I'll say very quickly that in Africa, bats are getting a lot of the blame for the last Ebola outbreak, fruit bats. It just isn't true. We have absolutely no evidence linking fruit bats to Ebola, period, none. So there really is no direct link. There's a lot of research being done on it, but there's no link at all. The truth is, don't eat wildlife and you won't have these diseases. Oh, there they are hanging out. One more look at them. One more look at Terrapus. You can help bats. Every one of us in Florida, everyone around the world, particularly where there's insect-eating bats, we can help these animals by replacing the lost trees that they used to live in that we cut down with bat houses just like this one. Bat houses can be put up in your yard, your front yard, your backyard, at a school, on a public park, playgrounds. Bats are in every environment in Florida. They're beachside, they're on barrier islands, they're in every environment. So don't worry about, you know, where you live. If you have space to put a bat house up, it's one extra step you can take to help these animals.